Bishop's casket from the hearse right now, and the Knights of Columbus are carrying him into the church.
So they're bringing up, right now, they're bringing up the body to Cardinal Roger Mahoney, who will begin the celebration.
May God the Father, who raised Jesus from the dead, be with you all.
And also with you.
Share with him eternal life. Thank you. On behalf of all of us, I'd like to extend our prayers and our sympathy to Bishop John's two brothers, members of their family and friends, as well as all of the members of the Diocese of Fresno. All of us come today in a great spirit of sympathy, but also in great hope in the promises of our risen Savior. So in that spirit, let us pray. O God, from the ranks of your priests, you chose your servant John Thomas to fulfill the office of bishop. Grant that he may share in the eternal fellowship of those priests who, faithful to the teachings of the apostles, dwell in your heavenly kingdom. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Lectura del libro de la sabiduría. Las almas de los justos están en las manos de Dios y ningún tormento podrá alcanzarlos. A los ojos de los insensatos están bien muertos y su partida parece una derrota. Nos abandonaron. Parece que nada quedó de ellos. Pero en realidad entraron en la paz. Aunque los hombres hayan visto en eso un castigo, allí estaba la vida inmortal para sostener su esperanza. Después de una corta prueba, recibirán grandes recompensas. Sí, Dios los puso a prueba y los encontró dignos de Él. Los probó como al oro en el horno, donde se funden los metales, y los aceptó como una ofrenda perfecta. Cuando venga Dios a visitarnos, serán luz, semejantes a la centella que corre por entre la maleza. Gobernarán las naciones y dominarán a los pueblos, y el Señor será su rey para siempre. Los que confían en Él conocerán la verdad. Los que fueron fieles en el amor permanecerán junto con Él. Palabra de Dios.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is no A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you,
Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. And he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right, and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on the right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him and say, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you?' And the king will say to them in reply, 'Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did for me.' Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill, and in prison, and you did not care for me.' Then they will answer and say, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry, or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs?' He will answer them, 'Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me.' And these will go off to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Your Eminence, Cardinal Mahoney, Your Excellencies, Archbishop Gomez, Archbishop Niederauer, Your Excellency, Bishops visiting from near and far, our visiting clergy, my brother priests of the Presbyterate of the Diocese of Fresno, deacons, deacon candidates, the religious present here today, all our attending religious leaders throughout the community of Fresno, our government and civic leaders, welcome. and to the family of Bishop Steinbock, Bob and Leo, and all your family members. God bless you all as we come here to honor Bishop John with these special prayers that the church has to offer, the perfect prayer, the Mass. John Thomas, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. That began it all. On that day and that moment, even in his mother's womb, God had a great plan for Bishop John. The day of his baptism, he was set apart, and the day of his baptism, he became one of the elect of the Lord. A great plan God had in store for him as he came into this world in July 16th, 1937. Bishop had a great entrance. It was on the Feast of Our Lady, of course. Our Lady of Mount Carmel, that he was born into this world on her feast day. A great welcome, a great beginning, and being baptized in the death and resurrection of Jesus, becoming a disciple of his. First of all, a great word of thanks to his mom and dad, to Mr. and Mrs. Leo Steinbock, for coming to the church, knocking on the door, and asking for the gift of baptism, the promise of salvation for their son. A great adventure began for Bishop John, with the parents bringing him up, that domestic church at home, fostering the faith, and eventually leads him to the seminary, to St. John's, finally to ordination to the priesthood of Jesus Christ, 47 years of priestly life God granted him. He was blessed with several parishes in the Archdiocese of Los Angeles, with the responsibility of being the steward of God's people, watching over them, ministering them, being a good shepherd to them. And then he was consecrated Bishop of the Diocese of Orange on July 14th, 1984. Scripture has something to say about bishops, the characteristics, the gifts of the Holy Spirit that they should have in their life, integrated in their life to serve God's people, to live out the fullness of the priesthood. Through Titus and Timothy, we hear, the bishop as God's steward must be blameless. He may not be self-willed or arrogant, a violent or greedy man. He should be hospitable and a lover of goodness, steady, just, holy, and self-controlled. In his teaching, he must hold on to the authentic message so that he will be able to encourage all to follow the sound doctrine and to refute those who contradict it. He should be irreproachable, of even temper, modest, gentle, a man of peace. Nor can he be someone who loves money. He didn't love money, but he was pretty thrifty with money. He must also be well thought of by those outside the church, all our religious leaders, interfaith leaders, reaching out, hand in hand, arm in arm, to ensure that he does not fall into the disgrace and the devil's trap. I think Bishop John fulfilled many of those characteristics. That love of money thing, I don't know. He's consecrated to Bishop, third Bishop of Santa Rosa in 1987, June of that year, fourth Bishop of this Great Diocese of Fresno on October 15th, 1991, and installed as our bishop in November of that same year of 91. And we were graced and blessed by the Lord and his generosity to serve us for 19 years as our bishop. And it was truly a great privilege for me to serve 11 of those 19 years as his vicar general. Unbelievable. You know, as a bishop becomes a bishop, he chooses a motto, he chooses a coat of arms, a seal, symbols that relate and speak clearly about his call, his mission, what's important to him in his spiritual life, really. And the coat of arms for Bishop Steinbock, the motto was, and this came early in his priestly formation in the seminary, all for the love of God. And the symbol was the cross. The major symbol on that crest, the cross, right in the center, dividing it up, speaking volumes to him, because he was acquainted with the cross. He was not just acquainted with the cross, he actually faced the cross and he embraced it. And he knew that there was no victory without it. It was all put into practice all the while as he acknowledged God's love, great love for his people, never forgetting that. Always putting the people first, loving them as God had loved him, reaching out. A love which strengthened him and led him to, and throughout his priestly life, which became a priestly life of sacrifice, a priestly life that is of self-offering, never holding back, no matter what, no matter how tired, never holding back. And of course, love for others. He was literally immersed in that dying and that rising that is called to mind in the second reading of today. Bishop John, immersed in the waters of baptism, rising out of those waters, empowered to serve the Lord, empowered to discern his call, which he did brilliantly. The Gospel of today mentions from Matthew chapter 25, that whole judgment seat when the glory of the Lord will return to judge us all. He fulfilled this gospel directly and indirectly as a bishop. Food for the hungry, drink to the thirsty, a stranger and welcoming them, naked and clothing them, ill and caring for them, imprisoned and visiting them. And he knew, and I'm sure the people who were at the receiving end knew, that it was out of love for Jesus he did it. In them, and they in turn reciprocating that love back to Bishop in gratitude, directly or indirectly. It became truly the foundation of what came to be known among us here in the diocese as his ministry of presence to us all. Being concerned about the needs of his parishes that he served in Los Angeles in the Archdiocese, being it out in Skid Row, living out this gospel, that street ministry that he immersed himself in that some of us would turn away from. The homeless that he encountered, the poor that he upheld and served through the Ministry of Catholic Charities, tirelessly in this diocese. Imprisoned, his visits to the prisons in this diocese, because we have a lot of them, selflessly going. I'll never forget him telling me, one of the greatest receptions I ever received was at the prison. I don't remember which one it was now, I don't recall, but the preparation, the dignity, the reverence, the open arms that he received from those inmates, he said, I'll never forget that. He said, I felt like a bishop. His concern for the immigrants and our migrant workers going out to the campesino work camps where the people lived and did their work, going there and the joy in the people's face, seeing the bishop coming to us, out here, out in the middle of nowhere, first communions basically, celebrating the Eucharist and celebrating life in the midst of them all. A great gift to them, a great living out, chapter 25 of Matthew. and throughout the Hispanic community. He had a great love for the Hispanic community. And then his outreach to his brothers and sisters of other faiths who are present here today. God bless you for being here. In your faith traditions, sharing with one another, ecumenically, interfaith. And his ministry of presence, of course, didn't end there. It spilled over into his administrative duties as bishop, as the chief administrator of the Diocese of Fresno. It spilled over into his relationship with me and vice versa, our working mutually together, the mutual support, being present to one another, ministry of presence that he shared with me, and it becomes contagious, bouncing it back. At times, I'd be in the office with him. Of course, sometimes there were never, a lot of times there's not a dull moment. Trying to figure out what's the best way to go, what is the discernment we need to make, and decisions. And sometimes I'd get a little excited about things. He'd be sitting in his chair at his desk. He'd lean back in the chair. He'd go, "Myron, God will take care of it." Just what I needed to hear. Or he'd say, "What a good life." As I'm walking out of his office, "Yeah, right, I don't get away." Or he would just simply say, "You know what, in all of this, God is good." That's what he'd say. And he said, "You know what the most important thing is in the midst of all this?" I'm thinking, here we go, right between the eyes. Jesus, he's the most important. That's it. Our love for Jesus and his love for us and our love for God's people. That's it. That's what's important. That's the top of the agenda. We'll get through whatever we're going to get through. Myron, God will take care of it. It spilled over into the pastoral center. It spilled in and through that chancery office, his presence to us, to the secretaries, to those holding down the fort day in and day out, in all the departments. His presence was strongly felt there. And when he wasn't around, people missed his presence. Is Bishop okay? He must be busy. We haven't seen him. When he wasn't around, there was a void, as there is a huge void now. In the chancery office, no matter what was going on, it could be, again, very trying things happening. And all of a sudden, I'm sitting in my office. A wall divided his office from mine. I thank God it was Bishop John Steinbock on the other side of that wall, my 11 years with him there. All of a sudden, I hear, walking down the hall, "Joy to the world." In June, I'm thinking, what have I gotten myself into? Spontaneous. That would just flow out of him. I was anywhere on the premises, but down the hall, loud and clear. And the laughs that would come out of that office. The door would be closed, you have an appointment, thinking, oh boy, this is going to be a tough appointment, maybe a little confrontational thing. All of a sudden, there's laughter coming out of there. Upbeat, positive, down to earth. No ceremonies about him. One of us, especially one in our priesthood. That presence of ministry spilled right into the presbyterate very powerfully. For all of us, all of you sitting over there. His priestly life connected with the priestly life of his brother priests as bishop. He was there for their concerns, being present to them, with you guys, dying and rising, in your brokenness and your healing. The door was open. I never, ever heard him say, "I just don't have time to meet with him right now. Could you have him set up an appointment?" Never. Unannounced, he received them. Received all of you guys. Then he would say, at major gatherings, like our convocation or the annual retreat, toward the end of the event, he would say, "You know what? The last thing I have to tell you, you're the best priest in the whole world." Kind of an inside thing with us over here. I don't care where we were, he would say that. And you know what? He believed it. We'd kind of roll our eyes. Here we go again. But he believed it. Because he told me that. Many times. The presence didn't stop there. It spilled over into our permanent diaconate, our deacons who serve the church so well in this diocese, the religious, those in formation, our seminarians, praying for them daily. And you know, Bishop was also, I don't know how many of you know this, but he was involved in a lot of missionary work too. He was out in the field a lot. You know, those green fields, the golf courses, bringing his ministry even there. He had a passion for that. That was a passion. At times I tell him, Bishop, I'm getting a little worried for you. I think we need to send you off to a program. I think you're addicted here. He loved it. And he loved the camaraderie with his brother priests and others who might just happen to be on the golf course and team up with him, not knowing he was a bishop. Down to earth, one of them. And then things began to shift a little bit, as the Lord has a tendency to do in our lives, to keep us on our toes. And we see that in the first reading from the Book of Wisdom. In the Book of Wisdom, it mentions that they were chastised a little. As gold in a furnace, God tried them, proved them. As a sacrificial offering, he took them to himself. And grace and mercy with was his holy ones, his elect, and his care for them. August of this year, Bishop, this was the most excited I think I ever saw him, anticipating his vacation, because August was, the whole month was blocked out for him. Looking forward to going down south, being with his brother, golfing, all the things, nothing major, but there was a major shift that happened in his life. He was diagnosed with cancer, lung cancer, at the beginning of that vacation. I just couldn't believe it. Looking down the road to retirement, I just couldn't believe it. It was his time for that spiritual fine-tuning that comes through suffering, being chastised a little, being put in that furnace as gold is purified, burning that owl out that doesn't belong there, so he's ready to take the next step from this life to the next. And to know that in the midst of all that, God's mercy and grace was working in and through him. Ministry of presence out to us, out to me, out to all who saw him and communicated with him. He did this all in reparation for sin. He told me that. I'm offering this all up, Myron. All for the love of God. During this time that he was diagnosed, he wrote an essay. Of course, you know, his wheels never stopped turning. Driving from the minute he got the news, coming back up north to the diocese, already his wheeling string, I'm going to write about this. I go, you are? He goes, but I can't, I just don't have the title yet. But it's about this whole thing with this diagnosis. He says, I just can't believe it. I don't feel sick. The denial thing. And he sat down and he began to write, and I bet it just flowed out of him. The Holy Spirit inspiring him. And he named and called, entitled rather, this work of his, an essay, as The Affliction of Cancer, a Christian perspective. As we speak, that is ministering to people. I've heard it. People have shared that with me. People are sending emails to us as they download that essay. Touching the people as we're here through his writing. He began his treatments, very diligent, of course. I gotta go to my treatment, I gotta go to my treatment. Okay, Bishop, take it easy. He'd go for his weekly visits, of course, but the first visit was something else. He said, I walked in there, he had his clerics on, his Roman collar, walks in, And the people who were there receiving their treatment saw him walk in and saw, hey, there's a priest coming. They said, oh, you're here to visit us, some ladies said. He goes, well, no. He says, I'm one of you. Ministry of presence and vice versa. Those visits, he never shared to me a lot about them, but I'm sure they were profound. What he did and said and what they said and shared with him. Building each other up in the midst of their challenge. And then things took a turn for the worst. And about a month ago, he ended up in St. Agnes Medical Center here in Fresno in critical care and ICU. Thank Cardinal Mahoney for coming to visit him on his way through town and back. And Father, our Bishop Blair from our neighbor to the north, Stockton, and the calls from bishops and the letters and unbelievable support among the bishops. He was in critical care for about a month. He spoke so loudly the message of Jesus in that bed to those who worked in that hospital and those who visited him. Spoke volumes. His pulpit was that bed, for sure. He even told me, he says, Myron, you know what? I go, what, Bishop? As he's laboring and speaking, because he would never shut up. I said, be quiet. Nobody could come to see you, Bishop. The doctors are saying, keep quiet, so you reserve your energy, your strength. One ear and out the other. He said, of all the sermons and homilies that I ever gave, for I don't care which function, what event, which mass, which liturgy was going on, it's never spoken as loudly as this, from this bed. No matter what it was, his kindness to those attending him, they were moved by that. He being positive and cheerful, as you know, my brother priests, and anyone knowing him, upbeat in the midst of, gasping for breath, as he laid on his there, on his pulpit, his bed. And let me tell you, if he wanted to be moved out of that room, he wanted that bed. He didn't want another one. He was comfortable in that bed as much as was possible. Spoke brilliantly through his suffering to those around him, attending him. The impact it had on that medical staff, they receiving from Bishop, Bishop receiving from those nurses and the doctors, those attending to his care, the compassion with all that, the way he praised the people taking care of him in that hospital, the medical and pastoral care he received there from St. Agnes. He praised them all for ministering to him, that presence of ministry. All those who were at his side, learning from him the importance of that ministry. Dr. Paul Mello, for his care over the years as his doctor. Mrs. Mary Kay Hackett and her husband Tom for their diligence and love for him at his side throughout all this. Monsignor Wenzinger, pastor of this parish, and for his pastoral visits. And for the many others who were there to visit him and to be at his side. And for Teresa Librada Aguirre, his devoted housekeeper for many, many years, would bend backwards for him, would go out of her way for him. We thank her for her presence. And for the many years, of course, of the presence of his family being with him, at his side, holiday times, times he'd go home down south, the presence of family, how important that is for us all. And I truly believe this presence of ministry became possible and a lived thing integrated so deeply in Bishop's life was because he sat in the divine presence of Jesus daily. You know, that holy hour. Sitting there in the midst of the Lord, quietly he being present to Jesus and Jesus being present to him. Each ministering the presence to one another, gazing at one another, giving and receiving that love, bringing that brokenness and healing to the Lord in his presence, Jesus knowing what that's all about, reassuring him. And then the profound mystery of this life, of that dying and rising in the presence of the Lord before the Blessed Sacrament. That helped him to live out this ministry of presence. His devotion to the Blessed Mother helped to foster that. She led him to Jesus in a powerful way, being born on her feast, loving Our Lady of Guadalupe, which we mentioned last night at the vigil service and the rosary. The Lord called him to himself on the feast of the Diocese of Fresno, in which we honor Our Lady Guadalupe. He looked forward to that celebration so much, and he just couldn't be there. And it was that Sunday the Lord called him. And I'm sure our Blessed Mother, at the foot of that bed, as we always say, pray for us now and at the hour of our death, she was there, without a doubt. A year ago, he presided over that gathering, and he shared a few words to the people, of course, in Spanish, a year ago. And I'd like to share just a few words of that. The first thing he said, I am not Mexican. No kidding, Bishop. He said, yo no soy Mexicano, ni por sangre, ni por raza. Pero por la gracia de Dios, yo soy guadalupano. He wanted to make that clear. Mirando a la Virgen Morena, saben que ella está con ustedes en las pruebas y sufrimientos de esta vida. Y que les ama como a su Hijo Divino. Nunca desaniman, ni pierden esperanza. La Iglesia nos recuerda en este tiempo de Adviento que estamos en peregrinación por esta vida. Y nuestro destino es el cielo y no necesita papeles para vivir en el reino de Dios, ni para entrar en el cielo. Estamos preparando en este tiempo de Adviento no solamente para celebrar la primera venida de Jesús en su nacimiento, pero también estamos preparando para recibirle en su segunda venida, cuando viene a juzgar a los buenos y los malos, o cuando viene a juzgarnos en la hora de nuestra muerte. Fiel a María y con devoción a nuestra Madre Celestial, no debemos tener miedo cuando viene Jesús, pero debemos estar listos para recibirlo con amor y alegría, porque Nuestra Señora está con nosotros. No tengan miedo. No soy yo su madre con ustedes. Yo soy su madre piadosa. Gracias, Señor Jesús, por el don de su madre como nuestra madre. Amen. Beautiful words, being ready for the coming of the Lord. And Jesus came for him in the season of the coming of the Lord, Advent. And he was preparing for that, of course. He knew the end was near. And I came across a few of his plans for the funeral. We are encouraged as clergy to always come up with some plans for the liturgy, so we kind of see what were some of the desires, maybe, in the planning stage of something like this. Well, of course, he had very few plans. Every blank was Vicar General, Vicar General. Keep it short. Too bad, Bishop. I'm sorry. Big deal. Keep it short. Let's not prolong things. He would have a fit with all this today. He wouldn't say, well, this is too much. It isn't too much. It's our bishop. First thing he wanted me to know. Funeral arrangements should be simple and inexpensive. The VG is in charge of arrangements, the liturgy. And then he had homilists and he had VG, Vicar General, written in there. And in the hospital, he said, Myron, are you getting things planned for me and all that? I go, yes, Bishop, we are. We're already anticipating things. And I said, but I do have a question. You said in the homily, it said Vicar General. Did you mean the Vicar General was responsible for choosing somebody to do the homily, or was it me? He said, well, it was you. Then he said, in the next breath, with a big smile and a laugh, in that hospital bed, so much for keeping it short. We had a good laugh. Then he said, please thank everyone for coming to the funeral, all of you, the great show of love for him. Then he said, especially all my fellow priests who have been such a support and joy to me through all my years of being a bishop. Tell everyone that my death is a gift, just as my life has been a gift. He says, please mention that if I ever hurt anyone, I beg their forgiveness. Now that was our bishop. That was our Bishop John. And may this saying of his stay with us. And there's many sayings that will be engraved in my mind, in my heart. All for the love of God. Keep it short. You're the best priest in the whole world. What a life. Myron, God will take care of it. God is good. How much is this going to cost? Joy to the world. Father of all that is good, keep us faithful in serving you, for to serve you is our lasting joy. Bishop, we pray that your joy will be complete now and forever. And in closing, a little reflection that he wrote on one of his bishop's retreat way back in 1985 of January of that year. May all I do, all I say, be for you and your glory. I seek nothing but you and your love. Well done, good and faithful servant. Now share in your master's joy. Amen.
My dear friends, let us join with one another in praying to God for our departed brother, John, and also for the church, for peace in the world and for ourselves.
For the Holy Father and all who preach the gospel, that they continue to be given the strength and courage to express in action the word they proclaim. For Bishop John, who shared in the priesthood of Jesus and served the church selflessly as a bishop, leading God's people in prayer and worship, that he be brought into your presence, where he will take his place in the heavenly liturgy. For the family and all friends of our bishop, for the people of Fresno, as they mourn the loss of their shepherd, that all may be consoled in their mourning by the gentle shepherd Jesus.
O God, hear us.
para los que llevan la cruz del dolor en la mente, cuerpo y espíritu, que nunca se sientan abandonados. Para todos los que cuidan a los enfermos y a los que sufren, especialmente aquellos que sirvieron al obispo Juan durante su enfermedad, que sean recompensados por su atención compasiva y amorosa bondad. Por todos los santos que nos han precedido, que descansen de sus trabajos terrenales y disfruten de la belleza y la abundancia de la fiesta celestial.
Heavenly Father, you entrusted Bishop John to our care, and now you embrace him in your love. Take him into your keeping. Comfort us who seek to do your will and to know your saving peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my friends, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church.
Merciful God, may this sacrifice, which John, your servant, offered during his life for the salvation of the faithful, help him now to find pardon and peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks.
Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ, our Lord. In him who rose from the dead, our hope of resurrection dawned. The sadness of death gives way to the bright promise of immortality. Lord, for your faithful people, life is changed, not ended. When the body of our earthly dwelling lies in death, we gain an everlasting dwelling place in heaven. And so, with all the choirs of angels in heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in their unending hymn of praise. Members of our Catholic community to kneel, others may be seated. Father, you are holy indeed, and all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, by the working of the Holy Spirit. From age to age, you gather a people to yourself, so that from east to west, a perfect offering may be made to the glory of your name. And so, Father, we bring you these gifts. We ask you to make them holy by the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate this Eucharist. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." When supper was ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, gave the cup to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it.
This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. To mind the death your Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension into heaven, and ready to greet him when he comes again, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look with favor on your church's offering and see the victim whose death has reconciled us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by his body and blood, may be filled with his Holy Spirit and become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make us an everlasting gift to you and enable us to share in the inheritance of your saints with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, with the apostles, the martyrs, and all your saints, whose constant intercession we rely for help.
Lord, may this sacrifice which has made our peace with you advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Strengthen in faith and love your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Pope Benedict, and all the bishops, with the clergy and the entire people your Son has gained for you. Father, hear the prayers of the family you have gathered here before you. In mercy and love, unite all your children, wherever they may be.
Remember Bishop John in baptism. He died with Christ. May he also share his resurrection. When Christ will raise our mortal bodies and make them like his own in glory. Welcome into your kingdom, our departed brothers and sisters, and all who have left this world in your friendship. There we hope to ensure in your glory, where every tear will be wiped away. On that day we will see you, our God, as you are. We shall become like you and praise you forever through Christ our Lord, from whom all good things come.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Let us pray with confidence to our Father in the words Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, and protect us from all anxiety as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you. Let us share with one another a sign of peace.
Jesus, our risen Lord, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those called now to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word and I shall be
Amen. blood of Christ. The blood of Christ.
Let us pray. Lord, give your mercy and love to John, your servant. He hoped in Christ and preached Christ. By this sacrifice, may he share with Christ the joy of eternal life. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
On behalf of my family, Bishop John's brothers, Father Leo and Robert, my mother and my siblings, it's a great honor to be here today and to speak to you about my uncle, Bishop John. My name is Robert Steinbock, Jr., one of Bishop John's 8 nephews. He also has 5 nieces and is a great uncle to 38 grandchildren. As a family, we were very fortunate to know Bishop John and to be a part of his life. We were blessed to see him every Christmas, Easter, and Thanksgiving, as well as many holy days and family days of celebration for almost 40 years. He was truly a great example to us all. We were honored to have Bishop John preside over many family weddings and baptisms, along with Father Leo. He always took time out for his family. In the early years, while he was at St. Fabiana's Cathedral, he would drive from Los Angeles into Orange County or to my grandparents' home in Covina to say hello. We all loved hearing his stories about his adventures while ministering to the people who lived on Skid Row in Los Angeles. He loved recalling these encounters and was a great storyteller. His stories always had me riveted and on the edge of my seat while waiting for what might happen next. And there always seemed to be a positive outcome. My grandparents, along with all of us, loved to play pinochle. Sometimes these games got pretty intense, and we all had to stop and ask God for patience and good sportsmanship before play could resume. Bishop John, however, always led by example. He was always a gracious winner and a gracious loser. He was always so kind, so relaxed, and so calm. He had a great gift of ministering to us and others simply by being present. His presence was one of holiness and peace. He was such a beautiful person. There were many occasions when my grandparents were unable to attend Mass, and Bishop John and Father Leo concelebrated Mass at home for all of us. Looking back, I can see how these were very special times. When Bishop John moved to Santa Rosa, the drive for him grew much longer and more difficult. But he always went out of his way to be with us. The drive from Fresno was still quite a distance, but Bishop John, despite his difficult schedule, made us all feel very special by attending our family gatherings. His prayers before family meals were always simple, short, but so very beautiful. He loved to tell jokes and had a great sense of humor. His laugh was infectious and so full of love and life. His stories about his ministry or about his golf game made us all feel like we were a part of his life. His demeanor never changed. He appeared to always be at peace with himself, with others, and with God, seemingly living in a constant state of grace. What a gift Bishop John was to us all. His life and legacy was his ministry to each and every one of us. Through his humbleness, he witnessed to us. Through his many talents, gifts, and charisms, he inspired us. He never stopped giving glory to God by simply being who he was and responding to God's call every step of the way, even in his own suffering, both at the end and all throughout his life here on earth. I'd like to close with Bishop John's own words, taken from his book, ministry of presence, and this is his closing for his book. I have come to realize ever more profoundly that the true purpose of our lives in this world is solely to give glory to God and to bear witness to his love and mercy in the circumstances of our lives. We are called to do this, even in our weakness and sinfulness, through the experiences, the stories, and the people that make up our lives. This is the activity of the Holy Spirit in our lives, for of ourselves, we can do nothing. Lasting and true happiness, peace and joy are only found in God, our Creator and Redeemer. The brilliance of Christ would light our darkness. Amen. Thank you.
Primeramente, yo quiero dirigir unas pocas palabras a la comunidad hispana aquí en la diócesis de Fresno, porque el obispo Juan tenía un amor muy profundo, muy cariñoso para con todos ustedes. Muchas veces durante sus años aquí me comentaba que él tenía tan mucha alegría en servir aquí los pobres y especialmente los hispanos, y especialmente durante el verano visitando los campos, ofreciendo la misa por los campesinos, ayudándolos en cualquier manera. Él vivía con el buen pastor entre ustedes. Ustedes tienen un lugar muy, muy importante en su corazón. Last month, when I went to visit, last month, when I stopped to visit Bishop John at St. Agnes, and he was in intensive care, and I walked into his room, and he has oxygen and is very struggle breathing, and he says, God is good. As we heard in our wonderful homily by Monsignor Cotta last night, Monsignor Peterson, his heart was always filled with that great goodness. However, in listening last night and today, I don't think enough has been said about golf. Okay. The grandnephew, your nephew, just mentioned something about him being a generous loser. And I didn't know who he was talking about. I only played two games of golf with Bishop John, and that was enough. The first time, see, he sets you up. So the very first time, He says, "Oh, I have this pain in the shoulder. And I'm really not sure if I can play very well today. So how about if we just bet 50 cents on this game?" And it all went progressively up from there. But then we're at down, and he's in the rough. His ball is the midst of all these weeds. And he walks over there, and he kicks the ball about 50 feet. Not just onto the fairway, but forward, too. And I said, "You can't do that." He said, "Yes, the rules say you can improve your lie." That was Bishop John's interpretation. The second and last game I was involved with him, we were putting on the green, and he was about 35 feet from the hole, and we're all putting away, and he just leans over and picks up the ball. And we said, "No, you have to hit the ball." He said, "That's a gimme." He said, "I always make those putts." So no reason to have to putt. Well, many games later, and many poor priests later, Bishop John loved the game. He loved golf. And he loved the camaraderie, and I think it really summed up all that we have heard about him today. But as we get prepared to take him to his final resting place, we all take fond memories, and I hope that all of us will share our favorite Bishop John stories among ourselves. They are to be treasured and to be kept really very precious in our hearts and our lives, that we too might imitate him. It was a joy to be with him in the seminary for those years, to be with him as a brother bishop. I did not serve with him as a priest in Los Angeles, but saw him on various occasions. And my lasting memory of him will be renewed once again as the bishops make our annual retreat January 2nd to 9th at the Cardinal Manning House of Prayer for Priests, because Bishop John always sat in one particular chair, and because we were seated in the small chapel facing each other, I was on one side, I could always see him on the other side. And the depth of prayer of Bishop John has always inspired me. His eyes would be closed, and he was obviously very deep in conversation with God and God with him. And so this year, for the very first time, unfortunately, I'll look over and for the first time not see him sitting there, not be inspired by his deep and wonderful and generous smiling face. But this year, he'll be looking down upon all of us and helping us to enter into that full prayer with Jesus, and also to face every situation with that wonderful and really faith-filled God is good. Let us stand now for our final prayers of commendation.
As the Cardinal prepares for the final commendation and farewell, an announcement for religious and for all clergy. If you wish to go to St. Peter's, we ask that you exit the Bullard Wing, and there you'll find buses present to take you to St. Peter's. There are four of them. We ask that you would quickly move to those buses. If you wish to go, enter into them, and we will see you at St. Peter's.
Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Bishop John, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see him again and enjoy his friendship. Although this gathering of family and friends will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. We now sprinkle his body with holy water, calling to mind his baptism and his entry into that risen life with Jesus. We surround him with incense as a sign of our own prayers and love reaching to heaven on his behalf. Into your hands, Father of Mercies, we commend our brother Bishop John in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In peace, let us take our brother John to his place of rest.